Today's reading comes from the book of Revelation, chapters 1 and 3. I, John, your brother and partner in the tribulation and the kingdom and the patient endurance that are in Jesus, was on the island called Patmos on account of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet saying, "Write what you see in a book and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus and to Smyrna and to Pergamum and to Thyatira and to Sardis and to Philadelphia and to Laodicea." Then I turned to see the voice that was speaking to me, and on turning I saw seven golden lampstands, and in the midst of the lampstands one like a son of man, clothed with a long robe and a golden sash around his chest. From chapter 3. To the angel of the church in Laodicea write, "The Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God, says this: I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish that you were cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. Because you say, 'I am rich and have become wealthy and have need of nothing,' and you do not know that you are wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked, I advise you to buy from me gold refined by fire, so that you may become rich, and white garments so that you may clothe yourself, and that the shame of your nakedness will not be revealed, and eye salve to anoint your eyes so that you may see. Those whom I love, I reprove and discipline. Therefore be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and will dine with him, and he with me. He who overcomes, I will grant to him to sit down with me on my throne, as I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Entitled today's sermon, Zest for the New Year. I think we all need some zest, some passion. And I want to thank you all for asking how my surgeries are and my recovery. The last surgery was in November. It's been about 2 months. And I got to tell you, I'm feeling old. Not just because of the surgeries, but when you start reminiscing and comparing physical therapy notes with people that you view as much older than yourself, you start to feel a little old. I say zest for the new year because it's still a new year, and it's 2017, and it's hard for me to believe that it's 2017. And actually, Susan saw something online. She goes, "My gosh, it's been 17 years since the year 2000. That's crazy for those of us that remember how far off 2000 seemed, and now we've blown by it. We're almost 20 years by it. And when I thought back to that year 2000, I tried to remember where I was, and I was preparing for the sermon, and I was a young engineer, but established in my career, working for a company called Procter & Gamble, and just, I thought I had arrived, I had made it. All my goals were around my identity, getting ahead at work, and being viewed positively. My material goals or my personal goals were all around my toys. I had a beautiful truck, I had a Harley, I had a boat. I was traveling all over the world, both for pleasure and for work. I thought I had it all. But yet, there was this emptiness, and I was always striving for the next possession or the next thing or the next compliment at work or whatever it was, and just a deep emptiness until the Lord drew me out of that. When I say drew me out, I don't mean to say that corporate America, there's anything inherently wrong with it. I love the business world, I love entrepreneurship, I love organizational management, but for me it had become my identity, an idol, something I was basing my life on, something I was too passionate in. And then when I was drawn out, I was just on such fire for the Lord, such passion. I was reading, and I didn't even like to read, and some of you have told me this is your experience too, but suddenly you have a renewed interest or a new interest in reading, and you read the Word of God as much as you can, you grab every book you can, you go to every Bible study you could, sharing your faith, you're telling others about the hope that lies within you. Then I heard this sermon, and this pastor preached a sermon and talked about when your faith gets dry and you're just going through the motions. And to me, that was just a crazy thought, like something I couldn't even fathom. Like, how could this passion that I have right now ever turn to dryness? But if you've been in the faith for any amount of time, you know that that's true, that there are points in your life where you are so on fire for the Lord. And then there's times where it's just dry. And you go through the motions. And the cares of the world set in, and you still say prayers before meals, and maybe your family worship time at night with your kids. Come to church, dress up, you say the prayers, and you leave, and you just know that there's an emptiness. Oftentimes, we don't know that emptiness is there until later, but we know something is wrong. And what I've come to realize is, again, it wasn't my career, as a successful career in corporate America, that was the problem. Because these times can occur in times of plenty and in times of want. They can occur in times when you have everything you've ever wanted, and you just sort of bask in it, and you turn off to the cares of the world and the cause of Christ, and you just are enjoying what you have and what you made for yourself. But then there are times when you don't have those things, and maybe most of us fall into that category. I don't know your level of income or whatever, but I know if you live in South Florida, you probably feel like you don't have enough. And so we set goals for ourselves. We want to get promoted. We want a better job. Maybe we need to move to a place with a lower cost of living. Or maybe the things that we're focused on are our identity at work, whatever job that is, being the best at it, upholding that identity, whatever it is, your desires and your hope, your love is misplaced. It's toward things and ideas and yourself and your own identity and not in the things of Christ. See, those things vie for your affections. And so I have a question for all of you. It's a question I've been asking myself a lot lately, but where is your treasure? Where's my treasure? And Jesus says, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And I just think that's an important question for us in 21st century South Florida. But I want to ask it a different way, because it's easy to be self-deluded in this, to think we have it all together. We're going to see that in this letter. So rather than where is your treasure, where would your neighbor say your treasure is? Where would your coworker, what would they say is important to you? Or your family members? What do they, if they look into your life and they say, man, George is really into this or that, what would that be for you? Because if it's anything but Jesus Christ, it's a misplaced passion, a misplaced zest. So we want to have a new zest for this new year. And we have a great letter to look at in the book of Revelation. Man, so much symbolism and interpretive grids are placed over the book of Revelation. Different ways to look at the end times, different... Any passage that's read from there, you automatically, if you have any knowledge or information about Revelation, you throw that grid right on it. And I'm here to tell you, we're not going to look at anything about end times, so I'm not going to give you any of those answers. Because this letter that we read to Laodicea is a letter, and it's a real letter, and it's written to a real church facing real problems, and Jesus, like a laser, addresses their problems. And if there's ever been any question in your mind as to the historicity of the Bible, this letter is going to be fascinating to you. Because there's so many subtle cues in it, what Jesus is talking about when you see what Laodicea is. You see, John says in chapter 1, and we looked at some chapter 1, that he's on the island of Patmos. It's off Asia Minor, and he's in prison there on cause of the gospel. See, people knew where his passion was, and he was exiled there. And he said he heard a voice, write a letter to the seven churches, and say, he said he turned to see the voice. Engaging both sight and hearing, eyes to see and ears to hear. And he turns to see the voice. And see, these seven churches on the mainland, they're arranged sort of in a circle. If you were to walk from city to city, it would be a long walk, but it would go in a circle. And it says when he turned to see the voice, he saw seven golden lampstands. And we learned that those lampstands stand for the churches. What a beautiful picture of what the church is supposed to be, a lampstand holding up the light to the world. But then he says, and then one like the Son of Man among them. The Son of Man, this was Jesus' favorite title for himself. It's out of the book of Daniel talking about the Messiah. And so what you have here is Jesus Christ, the King and head of the church, walking amidst his churches, seeing what they are doing, seeing what their passions are. And so this is probably what John sees over the landscape of the mainland, where those churches are probably. And the letters, we only write the letter to Laodicea. It's the seventh letter, it's the last one. And I think it's helpful for us to understand the outline of how each letter is written, because they're written following the same flow, the same components. So let's talk about that for a minute. The first part of every letter is the address to the angel of the church of Philadelphia, to the angel of the church of Laodicea. That's who it's to. The next part, in our case, it says the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of creation. It's a description of Jesus. So who it's to? Laodicea, who it's from? Jesus. But the description of Jesus is directly out of chapter 1. We didn't read all of chapter 1, this beautiful vision of Jesus. To another church, he described himself differently. He says, the one who had the two-edged sword coming out of his mouth. Again, referring to a component that John saw in chapter 1. Then the body of the letters have three main parts. A commendation, something good that the church is doing, that Jesus has seen, and he's commending them, he's encouraging them for that. A condemnation, something bad. I have this against you, he says. And then some instruction about how to work that out. And then every letter ends with, in the conclusion, a promise. And this is a beautiful thing. Just like the description of Jesus refers back to something in Revelation, the promise always is a promise to those who overcome. They get to share in what they see later in Revelation, the victorious Christ has conquered and earned as inheritance. We get to share in it. And so that's the flow of the letter. Now, why do I tell you that? Because where a letter will deviate from that flow is instructive. For instance, two of the letters have nothing bad going on in the church. No condemnation. Just, I see your works, and I love it, and keep on. And some two of these churches are going to go through persecution, and Jesus just encourages them. And so put yourself in the Laodicean believers' shoes. They're the last letter. They're hearing message after message to six churches before them. They hear a lot of good things. They hear a lot of bad things. What are they thinking Jesus is going to say to them? Well, we see from this letter that this is a rich church, and it's a church steeped in self-righteousness. And so you can't help but think that they were probably making comparisons in their mind. I think back to TJ's New Year's Day sermon for a less stressful New Year. Great sermon. Convicting, but so much hope, and just such a great message. I encourage you to get it. And in it, he looked at the prayer of the Pharisee and the tax collector. And the Pharisee said, thank you, Lord, for all the blessings that I have. He prayed to himself, right? Thank you that I'm not like that tax collector. And I can't help but wonder if that letter could be put over the grid, as a grid over this church. And as they hear the good things, and especially the two churches with nothing bad said about them, they probably thought, that's probably us. You can't find anything wrong going on in this church. Look at us. We're proper people. We come to church. But worse, the judgment they were probably passing when they would hear all the sins in the other churches. For instance, to one church, Jesus says, you have a reputation for being alive, but you're dead. I think, like, imagine if Jesus walked in right now and I gave him a mic real quick and we want to hear what he's going to say, and he tells the church they're dead. To another, you've lost your first love, he says. You don't say that that's what he'd be saying to these Laodiceans, but he doesn't say that to them. It makes you wonder if they ever had Jesus as their first love. Two of the churches were so steeped in sexual immorality and idolatry, and I can just picture these Laodiceans hearing them. They were right before Laodicea and just, wow, what's going on there? We don't do that. We don't have that going on publicly. And then it comes to the angel of the church in Laodicea, and they're probably listening, and here it is. What's he going to praise us for? And he says, I know your deeds. You are neither cold nor hot. I wish that you were cold or hot, so because you are lukewarm, I will spit you out of my mouth. What a horrible thing to be said about you. If you claim Jesus as Savior and Lord, he wants to spit you out of his mouth. And so Jesus comes in, and this letter says he's a witness, the Amen, the faithful and true witness. He knows exactly what's going on. But Luke's gospel also tells us he's the great physician, and it's almost like Jesus comes in as the doctor, and he takes their temperature, and he looks at their symptoms, and he says, you have a disease, and it's lukewarmness. And I know what I'm talking about. And the analogy he uses is hot and cold. You're lukewarm, you're not hot, you're not cold. We take that as extremes on the spiritual spectrum, and it is. It's meant to be that, on fire for the Lord or just cold toward God. But there's something very interesting that the historians have learned about Laodicea and the neighboring towns. There's two cities near them, Colossae and Hierapolis. And Hierapolis was known for beautiful hot springs, had medicinal and therapeutic purposes. People would go there for this. I don't know if hot springs are big in our country anymore. There's a lot of places around the country with hot springs, and in the 1800s and early part of the 1900s, it was big for people to go to hot springs. They actually retreat there for a long time, just let it soothe their body. Colossae had mountain cold water. You know what I mean? You ever go to the mountains and you just put the glass up to the faucet and you just turn it on, and as it fills it up, it's cool in your hand. You don't need an ice cube, you can just drink it. It's Colossae. See, Laodicea didn't have their own sustainable water source. They had to actually aqueduct in water from miles away. And you could actually see pictures of this online. It's fascinating. You could see these stone ducts and the hole that goes through it, how it was calcified with sediment and caking over. And by the way, I see John Stevenson nodding. They've been all over that place, so you guys should talk to them after this. And how it's caked over. And historians will tell us that the water, by the time it reached Laodicea, was full of sediment and it was tepid. One historian writes that visitors weren't used to the water. It had an emetic effect. Emetic, to emit, to spit out. Gives context to why would Jesus say he's going to spit that out? He's using the cultural context that they have that's going on right there. And this word that Jesus uses for hot, zestos, zest, fire. It's immense heat, it's fire, it's passion. It had no passion. It's the disease of lukewarmness. And so, if this is really a disease and it's so serious that Jesus doesn't even... I mean, think about this. Even the dead church had something good said about them. Not Laodicea. So we should want to know, what is this disease and how do you get it? And so we're going to look at the rest of the sermon at the risk factors, the symptoms, and the cure. Because I have to tell you folks, here in modern day America, we have the risk factors. And then we'll look at the symptoms and the cure. Jesus indicates that this disease has set in because of their wealth. There's something you have to know about Laodicea. They had three major industries in Laodicea. And this is where the history is just fascinating stuff. One was a banking industry. And how that works is they were in the hub of all these trade routes coming in and out. And so they accumulated all the wealth because people were coming in and out of the town and they were doing commerce there. Their currency is actually backed by gold. You see Jesus talking about gold here. So they had a thriving banking finance industry. The next one was a medicine. They had a medical school there, a hospital. And they produced from this Phrygian powder this eye salve. And you see Jesus mentioning eye salve here, this ointment. And you know, blindness was and eye conditions were just a big thing in the ancient world, especially the dusty conditions and all that. They also had cures for ears, and so they were known for medicine. So much so that two of their doctors were on their coins. So they have a healthcare industry, a banking industry. The third one is textile, or really fashion. See, they had this really unique and rare breed of sheep there. Jet black wool, and it produced these beautiful garments that people would want, so they want to export the materials and also the garments and the fashion out. And so when you think of those three industries, how modern, really, that banking, healthcare, and finance, banking, healthcare, and fashion. Sounds a lot like maybe South Florida, a lot like New York City, certainly. And so I wonder for us, like, how that computes. I was thinking, like, when we drive on I-95, if there's any question in your mind of how identity and fashion, you just have to look at the billboards and hold your kids' eyes as you do all the different fashion trends or things you could do to your body to try to cheat the aging process or whatever. Just fashion and identity are such a big thing in our culture. Obviously, healthcare is, and money, and banking and finance. I mean, we are a culture obsessed with insurance policies and retirement plans and college accounts, and yes, I have all those. We like those things. So how does this play in? Because again, I say this is a risk factor. This is not the problem. Hear me on that. The Bible doesn't say that money is the root of all evil. It says the love of money is the root of all evil. So the fact that people were wealthy is not the issue. Just a risk factor. For us, maybe we're not wealthy, but we are in the top 90% of the world, so we are pretty wealthy. And maybe if we don't have the wealth we want, it's us trying to retain the wealth we want. But whatever it is, it becomes a fixation for us. Reminds me of the rich young ruler comes to Jesus and asks him, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus has been saying that nobody follows the Ten Commandments. Because if you've hated somebody, it's the same thing as murdering. And if you've lusted after somebody, it's adultery. And this guy asks that, so Jesus plays along. And he engages in the dialogue. And he tells him, follow these commandments. He tells him some of the commandments around loving others. And rather, the man says, well, nobody can do that perfectly. The man says the opposite. He says, I have done that. I've obeyed them my entire life. And so then Jesus goes to the heart of the matter and says, okay, that's one thing you lack. Sell all you have, give to the poor, and follow me. And so the man walked away very sad and holding on to his stuff. And you know, when we're in this posture, holding on to our stuff or our identity or whatever it is that makes us who we are, whatever we're trusting in, you can't receive because you're hoarding. I love America and I love the American dream, the idea that people are rewarded for hard work for the most part. That we can be whatever we want to be. But folks, the American dream can so easily become idolatry. And I was thinking back to another sermon TJ preached, I don't remember which one it was, and it was talking about idolatry in the Old Testament, and it was pagan cultures, and how the highest price that could be paid was the sacrificing of your kids in that. And we think that's like, what? Throwing our babies to Molech in the fire? That's crazy. Next week is the anniversary of Roe versus Wade, where 50 million babies have been sacrificed for the American dream. Very sad commentary on our culture. Because when we want other things, we'll sacrifice all else, and people can see what's important to us in those moments. And so those are risk factors. Again, risk factors. I'm not telling you not to have a retirement account. I'm not telling you not to save. So let's look at the symptoms. Because just having the risk factors, and we each have them in our life, just having those factors in existence, we all have. So we really want to know what are the symptoms of this disease of lukewarmness. And it's really interesting where Jesus goes on this, because you would think he would go straight to their heart as the evidence, like to their faith, right? But actually, we can't misunderstand this, but actually he goes to words and deeds, to their works and what they say, because those are symptoms of the larger heart problem. The first thing he says, I know your deeds. You are neither cold nor hot. We looked at that. And the idea there is, you're neither cold nor hot about me, about Jesus. So they're pretty hot about their bank accounts. You just picture them sitting around Starbucks, talking about the markets and the economies, talking about what kind of laws are coming out of Rome and how they'll affect trade in their town. But their deeds reflect that they're not passionate about the things of Christ, that Jesus Christ is not supreme in their life, that he's not the most important thing to them. Then he goes to their words. So he says, I know your deeds. Verse 15, verse 17, because you say, so here's your words, I'm rich, I become wealthy, and I have need of nothing. I have need of nothing. And so their life is a life of one self-sufficiency. And so even their words decry that they view their material wealth as equating to spiritual health. Remember, James writes this, but someone will say, you have faith and I have works. James says, show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. Our works are the symptoms of what we treasure. Because remember, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Expresses itself in how we love one another and how we love God in action, in word, and deed. But this saying, I have need of nothing, I'm rich and have need of nothing, this is another fascinating thing. So Tacitus, this ancient historian from Rome, he records this little sentence in his annals of Rome. It says there was an earthquake and it had destroyed Laodicea. And actually, it destroyed Colossae and Hierapolis too. And Colossae, to my knowledge, after the earthquake, did never rebuild. So I'm glad we have a letter to the Colossians, because that was written before that. But Laodicea said that it said they rebuilt their city without any help from Rome. And historians are pretty much agreement that the implication is that they turned down the help from Rome, probably saying, I am rich, I have become wealthy, we need nothing, we'll do it on our own. That's the attitude in their life that had then trickled into their spiritual life. But that same phrase is also a quote out of Hosea, which is in the Old Testament, written hundreds and hundreds of years before. It says this, Hosea records, ah, but I am rich, I have found wealth for myself, in all my labors they cannot find in me iniquity or sin. Did you make that connection? It's talking about wealth, but then suddenly it goes to sin. Say again, I am rich, I found wealth for myself. Accumulated wealth. Physical satisfaction. And then it says, they cannot find in me iniquity or sin. You see, this is why the risk factor turns into the symptom, because when we start equating our physical blessings and the things we have and our accomplishments and our identity as meaning that we are not sinners and that we are spiritually on par with what we have physically, we become self-deluded. See, the disease of lukewarmness is a disease of self-sufficiency and self-confidence. Other things satisfy us. In all cases, it's a sin of unbelief. Because if we truly believed the gospel, Jesus would be most precious to us, and we wouldn't find these other things more satisfying. But we're constantly messing around with these other things. How this plays out in our works? There was a popular Christian thing going around. I don't know who started it. I think it makes a good illustration. But it was, if you were arrested for being a Christian, would there be enough to convict you? That's sobering. And again, if you're like, no, that's works, I don't go to works. Well, remember what James said, but what about what Jesus says? Jesus is talking, he says, you will recognize them by their fruits. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Is that the same thing he's telling these Laodiceans? I know your works, I'm going to spit you out of my mouth. No good fruit, cast into the fire. Again, don't misunderstand me. I want to be clear on this. He's not saying then go do good works. And that's going to fix the problem. Any more than if you have the flu, then blowing your nose is going to cure the flu. See, the expression of our love out in society and to one another is always because we're receiving grace and it just so fills us up that it has to bubble out. Can't force yourself to do it. Has to be real, has to be eternal, has to be zest. I think part of the problem is we're just so self-absorbed. It's a culture, individually. We even have a word for it, right? Selfies. You know, you turn the camera around and you take the picture. And I used to joke with my students when digital cameras, I was a teacher, digital cameras had come out, they had cameras on your phones, and you could see yourself. And they take, like, I was taking perfect selfies before there were even digital cameras, and you had to actually push a button, not just tap a screen. And then you had to wait a week to get the thing developed to even know if you're in the picture. I I always take the selfies, waterfalls and beautiful scenery behind me, Grand Canyon, try to squeeze in Susan. But then, have you noticed, have you gone on social media? I mean, now the selfies don't even include the backdrop anymore. Just people against a white wall, or in the mirror, and all posed, and they gotta get the exact right pose, and just the light shining on themselves, on their own fame. Like I said, I'm guilty of a selfie. Jesus says this, he says, "You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven." Our deeds and our words go out and they show love to others, and it's out of belief and out of passion, and people can't help but look and say, "Wow, why? Why do you do that?" And you have a reason to tell them. So we can't cure this disease by trying to be better. Can't clean ourselves up. Can't act better. Can't fake it till you make it. But they are the symptoms. So let's look at the cure. Let's look at what the cure is. Jesus says, "I counsel you," or "I advise you to buy gold from me, refined by fire so that you may become rich, and white garments so that you may clothe yourselves, that the shame of your nakedness will not be revealed, and eye salve to anoint your eyes so that you may see." Notice what he's telling them to buy. It's the three industries that they think their identity is built on, and they think makes them strong. It's, again, finance, healthcare, and fashion. But the odd thing is when he says, "I advise you to buy." Because what's he saying? I mean, how do you buy? Does that mean take your money and give it to the church? How do you buy from Jesus? So you know, it has to be in the context of this letter. What did he just say about them immediately before? He says, "You are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, naked. You have nothing to offer." So you can't say in one verse you're poor and have nothing, and the next verse, "Buy for me," and us interpret that as us having to do something because we have nothing to purchase with. In the prayer that TJ prayed, included this from Isaiah 55. Here's a little bit more of it. "Come, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And he who has no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which is not satisfying? Listen diligently to me and eat what is good, and delight yourself in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Hear that your soul may live. Come to the water. Come to everyone who thirsts." You buy, it says, without money, without price. He who has no money, you buy. How do you buy without money? I see him here, so I'll have to mention it. Ronaldo, when we were talking about this the other day, he goes, "The only way to buy without money is you receive. You receive. You have nothing to offer." I know you don't have Isaiah 55 in front of you, but it's amazing how Isaiah 55 is explaining the cure to what's going on in Laodicea. It says, "Come everyone who thirsts." And Jesus opens the letter up talking about thirst. Talking about hot and cold and spitting. "Come everyone who has thirst. Come buy without money," it says. And then at the end, "Incline your ear and hear." And Jesus says, "To those who have ears to hear, let them hear." In the economy of God, salvation is free, and you buy without money. There's no price. You receive. Receiving is acknowledging your need. All who are thirsty. If you say you have nothing, you have need of nothing, then you don't come get a drink. All who are thirsty. You repent and believe. That's what the text says, right? It says, "Be zealous and believe." We need eyes to see. We need ears to hear. Now let's look at what Jesus offers. Gold refined with fire so that you may become rich. Gold refined by fire. The impurities are out of it. It's spiritual riches. Spiritual riches unstained by self-righteousness and your own sort of input to it. It's pure spiritual riches. White garments that you may clothe yourselves. Not like the beautiful black physical garments that you have. I love black clothing yourself, but pure white you'll be clothed in. Earlier last year, I preached a sermon called The Great Exchange, where our sin nature is placed on Jesus Christ, and all our sins are placed on Him, and His righteousness is placed on us. When I preached on Galatians and Romans and Martin Luther, when he finally realized that the righteousness of God that comes by faith is Jesus Christ's righteousness that is applied to us, we get His pure garments, His record. And he says, an eye salve to anoint your eyes so that you may see. We need the scales removed from our eyes, and the Spirit does that for us. And like Paul, who was Saul, who was once persecuting the church, Jesus gave him eyes to see, and that's what we need. We need that for spiritual discernment. Only Jesus can offer us these things. Jesus is uniquely positioned to offer these things to us, because it was He who became poor so that we could become rich. It was Jesus who was mocked and blinded by the guards so that we might have sight. And it was Jesus who was stripped naked and His shame put on display on a cross so that we could be clothed in His righteousness. He gave up everything so we can have everything that is His. And He offers it to us free. It's a gift. And this Jesus and this hard letter and condemnation, He says, those whom I love. How sweet is that? Those whom I love, I reprove and discipline. Therefore, be zealous and repent. See, they might be lukewarm to Him, but He has love for them. How do you receive this? It says, be zealous and repent. Here's the thing about being zealous. You can't be zealous because I tell you to be zealous. Now, I'll give you an example. Well, the camping trip's a great example, because I talk to some people that come camping with us, and they say, I hate camping. I can't tell them, like camping, if they don't like it. So Jesus is saying to be zealous and repent. You can only be zealous if you believe. Because you can't, you're not going to, again, like the disciples, they all were martyred, right? Nobody's going to die for a lie. They were on fire. I think that's why these letters to the churches are placed, they're sandwiched between beautiful visions of Jesus. In chapter 1, you have the most magnificent vision of the risen Lord anywhere. I mean, John fell as if dead when he turned and he saw Him. Conquering Jesus, creator of the world. And this is the beautiful thing in that, and you should read it, where Jesus goes over and puts His hand on Him. He says, be not afraid. How sweet is that? Beautiful vision of Jesus. Then the letters. And then chapter 4 and 5 are the throne room of God. The idea is, we try to satisfy ourselves with all kinds of stuff here on earth. And we have the most magnificent Savior, the most precious thing in the world, in the gospel and in Jesus Christ. And John, in words, and they don't even do it justice, but he tries to paint these pictures of what we're missing out on. We really believed that, we would be zealous and on fire, and our light would shine and people would see it. And again, that question, what would people say about us? And that's why I just want this message to sink into us, so that we can have a new zest for this new year. The message ends with a promise, and a great promise it is. It's the promise for the church collectively, Laodicean Church, for the individual believers. So therefore, I take it as a promise to us as the body of believers, St. Andrews. I take it for us individually. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and will dine with him and he with me. Would we open the door for him, saying, wouldn't that be amazing? I'm here to tell you, he's here with us. And individually. And here's the thing. At the beginning of the letter, Jesus is spitting them out of his mouth. What does he say he wants to do with them and he's willing to do with them? Have a meal with them. Dine with them. Now, I know meals and dining gets all mixed up in our culture now, because so many homes have just like a revolving door dining room from 5 o'clock to 8:30, depending on when the people come home and grab it. But not in the Middle East. That was a banquet. That was a meal. That was an opportunity. It was a relationship. It was an intentional getting to know one another opportunity. Maybe you've lost your passion and just the cares of the world have seeped into your life and you have real problems. I know that. So many people last year lost loved ones. It's a crazy, crazy year for that. People over the last few years have been out of work for a long time. I get it. Those cares of the world, they creep in. But maybe those cares of the world and either what you've already accomplished or what you're trying to accomplish is just your faith is dry right now. This promise is for you. Or maybe you haven't. You're not a Christian. You don't consider yourself a Christian. And you see in yourself, you have all these desires, these earthly desires, the worldly desires, and yet you realize they don't satisfy. They're not doing it for you. And so you're on to the next one, and the next one. And maybe you're tired of running like that. This message is for you. Jesus says, he who overcomes, I will grant to him to sit with me on my throne. He who has an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to churches. So let me read at one time. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and will dine with him and he with me. Will we let him in? Will you let him in? Be zealous and repent. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for the beauty and magnificence of your Son put on display, Father, in the gospel. This Jesus who gave up his riches, gave up his rights for a time to come down, Lord, beaten, crucified for us, and our sins were placed on him, Father, so that we could have all of the benefits that he has. It's our inheritance. Help us to see that with new eyes, Father, what you offer us in the gospel, and we can come and we're called to buy it, but not with money, because we have nothing we can offer. We just come with open arms, Father. Lord, that is my prayer for St. Andrews, for the people here today, Lord, that we would be so zealous. We believe this message so much that it couldn't help but to bubble over and out and be passionate in our communities, in our workplaces, in our neighborhoods, and that people would ask us for the hope that lies within us, and we would tell them about your Son, Jesus. It's in his name that we pray. Amen.